The next morning, on our way from Clifton to the Dingle Peninsula, we drove across the heart of the Connemara Peninsula, one of the wildest and least developed parts of Ireland, with sheep grazing in open range fields. The scenery here is incredible. The mountains are some of the 12 bends, or peaks, that line the peninsula. I passed the city of Galway and entered an area a few miles south called the Burren. Burren means barren, which exactly describes these bare limestone hills. One of Cromwell's officers in the mid-1600s said the Burren is a country where there's not enough water to drown a man, wood enough to hang one, nor earth enough to bury him. Leaving the Burren up a hairpin turn road, we stopped at this scenic overlook looking back to Galway Bay. The fierce winds here whipped my favorite Virginia Tech Hokies hat from my head. It's probably still somewhere out over the Atlantic, hopefully sailing back home to America. As we continued driving south of the Burren down the west coast, we came to the Cliffs of Moher, which rise as high as 700 feet above the ocean. When Tim and I visited here 20 years ago, there were no barriers or fences along the tops of the cliffs. However, a spate of suicides in recent years has resulted in their building. O'Brien's Tower at the top of the cliffs after a brisk climb. To cut 90 miles off the trip down to Dingle, we bypassed the city of Limerick by crossing from Killamer to Tarbert on this car ferry. Arrived in Dingle, where we stayed two nights. This is the village of 2000 on Dingle Bay, across which Charles Lindbergh caught his first glimpse of land on his way to Paris in 1927. We heard much Gaelic being spoken here, as we did throughout Western Ireland. It's taught in the schools, and most signs in the Republic are in Gaelic. The Tower View B&B looks out across the village and the bay. Its charming owner, Mary, lived in Boston for 8 years and rolled out a big welcome mat. The next morning, we took a boat trip on the bay to see Dingle's most famous resident, Fungi the Wild Dolphin, who first came here to the harbor in 1983 and has lived here ever since. He's quite elusive, but if he's not spotted, the boat trip is free. Dingle is a charming but somewhat touristy town. Fishing and tourism are its primary businesses. Later in the day, we enjoyed a 4-hour privately guided tour of the Dingle Peninsula. This was the home of Lord Ventry, an English nobleman who owned most of the peninsula in the late 1800s. He was typical of the lords who controlled most of the Irish land for almost 400 years. Ogham stones are found throughout Ireland. The vertical and horizontal marks on the stones represent a 20-character Celtic language, almost 1500 years old, that was used to communicate messages and mark land boundaries. This gorse-covered mound is called a ring fort. There are over 45,000 of these structures all over Ireland. This picture, not taken by me, shows the typical configuration of a ring fort. It's believed a farmer lived with his family and animals within the walls of the fort, which provided protection from attacks and kept the animals safe from predators. The Irish have a lot of legends about fairies inhabiting the forts today, and if disturbed, bringing bad luck on those who do the disturbing. Slea Head is the westernmost part of Europe. Just off Slea Head lie the Blasket Islands. Most of the settlers lived on Great Blasket Island. In the 1920s and 30s, Great Blasket Island writers produced books which are deemed classics in the world of literature. They wrote of island people living on the very edge of Europe and brought to life the topography, life, and times of their island. They wrote all of their stories in the Irish language. Sadly, the Blasket Island community declined as a result of the persistent immigration of its young people, until eventually the island was abandoned in 1953, when only 22 inhabitants remained. One of the Blaskets is called the Sleeping Giant. of our favorite movies, Ryan's Daughter, was filmed on Dingle in the late 1960s. The only remaining set from the movie is the schoolhouse, where Robert Mitchum's character taught and lived with his wife, played by Sarah Miles. One of the many beautiful Dingle beaches. Gallarais Oratory is a small Catholic church built around the 6th century. The stones were placed without mortar and are so tight that the rain cannot enter. We can attest to this fact because we visited it in a torrential downpour. Here's a picture I borrowed, taken on a drier day. Dennis Ryan, our guide, and Barb are standing in dryness near a small window that frames the sun perfectly on one day of the year, the summer solstice. The monks built it this way to impress the pagan Celts, whom they were trying to convert. That night, we went to John Benny Moriarty's pub to get sample Dingle pub grub and to hear some traditional Irish music. While we were eating, an older man and his younger girlfriend sat down beside us, and soon we were talking like old friends. He was Paddy O'Brien, a former TV personality from Cork, and a true Irish character. A little later, in came a priest, Father Frank, and his two female friends. They squeezed in beside us, and we had a real party going. Paddy kept things livened up with his Irish ballads and stories. We found once again that stranger is not a word the Irish have in their vocabulary. The following morning, after filling up on another great Irish breakfast featuring Barb's favorite puddings, we reluctantly departed Dingle and drove toward the Cork area. On the eastern end of the peninsula, we overlooked Inch Beach, where most of the beach scenes from Ryan's Daughter were filmed. We bypassed a very congested Killarney, where a car rally was taking place, and drove just to the south to Killarney National Park and its famous Muckross House. Muckross House was built by an Irish politician in 1843. The family spent 6 long and expensive years preparing the house for a visit by Queen Victoria in 1861, and she stayed a grand total of only 2 nights. The house was later owned by a member of the Guinness Brewing family and then by an American couple. Today, it is owned by the Irish government and has beautiful gardens of gigantic azaleas and rhododendrons. It lies alongside one of the lakes of Killarney. Our stop for the evening was near the town of Macroom, a few miles west of Cork. Macroom was the birthplace of Admiral Sir William Penn, the father of William Penn. Penn spent a great deal of time in his father's birthplace, particularly during his childhood. Here are the remains of the Penn family castle. We stayed that night at the Fountain House B&B, which has been run by the same family for several decades. It had some beautiful grounds out back, fronting a lake. The next day on our journey up to Dublin, we bypassed Cork and toured the nearby Jameson Irish Whiskey Distillery in Middleton. Jameson has been making its brand here for over 200 years. Barley is brought into this house where it is dried. Here's the giant water wheel, which at one stage powered all of the distillery machinery, and today still turns the cogs and wheels in the mill building. This is the largest pot still in the world. The aging barrels are actually reused Jack Daniel's barrels imported from the U.S. At the end of the tour, a tasting session pointed out the differences among Irish, Scotch, and American whiskies. The main difference is that the Irish doesn't use peat in the malting process, giving it a very clean taste by removing the earthy flavor of Scotch and American whiskies. Whoa, baby! It tickled the nose and the throat. About midway between Cork and Dublin is the Rock of Cashel, that served as the traditional seat of the kings of Ireland for several hundred years prior to the Norman invasion of Ireland in the late 1100s. Several hundred townspeople were massacred by Cromwell's soldiers when they sought shelter inside the cathedral walls seen here. Cormac's chapel was quite advanced for its ceiling design built in the 13th century. We arrived in Dublin, where we would spend our last two nights in Ireland. The Jury's Inn Christ Church is right in the middle of town and across the street from Ireland's most famous church, Christ Church Cathedral. We stayed just down the street from Dublin Castle. It was the center of British rule of Ireland for hundreds of years until the Irish Republican Revolution in the early 20th century. The Statue of Justice stands above the entrance to the castle. During British rule, when the castle symbolized everything the Irish hated about their occupiers, the locals would say, "There she stands above her station, with her face to the palace and her arse to the nation." Trinity College, Ireland's oldest, was founded in 1592 by Queen Elizabeth I. We joined a tour of the college conducted by a student. The only Trinity building that permits visitors inside is the old library, holding the famous Book of Kells, an illuminated manuscript in Latin containing the four Gospels of the New Testament. It was transcribed by Celtic monks around 800 AD. It's a masterpiece of calligraphy and illumination, hundreds of years ahead of its time, before similar works would be completed in the Renaissance. It's also widely regarded as Ireland's finest national treasure. Upstairs from the Book of Kells is the Long Chamber, which holds the famous Irish harp that appears on Irish coins. One of the few remaining copies of the 1916 Proclamation of the Irish Republic, equivalent to the U.S. Declaration of Independence, is also there. O'Connell Bridge crosses the River Liffey. The monument to Daniel O'Connell, the Great Liberator. He was an Irish political leader in the first half of the 19th century. He campaigned for Catholic emancipation, the right for Catholics to sit in the Westminster Parliament, denied for over 100 years, and repeal of the union between Ireland and Great Britain. The historic work of O'Connell and others like Charles Sturt Purnell and Robert Emmet came to fruition on Easter Day, 1916. The leader seized the General Post Office shown here, raising a green flag bearing the legend Irish Republic and proclaiming independence for Ireland. 16 of the uprising leaders were assassinated, and this resulted in a 7-year war of independence that ended in 1923 with the creation of the Irish Republic. Bullet holes from the uprising can be seen in the post office columns. This statue of poet James Joyce stands across O'Connell Street from the post office. Here's where the pints I had imbibed happily for the past week are brewed. Kilmainham Jail has played an important part in Irish history, as many leaders of Irish rebellions were imprisoned and some executed in the jail for over 100 years. One of the 1916 Easter Day Uprising rebels, Joseph Plunkett, was allowed to marry Grace Gifford in the jail's chapel and to spend a few minutes with her in his cell shown here before his assassination. This was the cell of the uprising's leader, Patrick Pearse. Fifteen of those who led the Easter Uprising of 1916 were executed here by firing squad between the 3rd of May and the 12th of May. The Irish tricolor flag flies at the site of the executions. The green on the flag symbolizes the Gaelic tradition, and the orange symbolizes the supporters of William of Orange. The white in the center symbolizes a lasting truce between the green and the orange. The River Liffey divides Dublin. The Halfpenny Bridge over the River Liffey was built as a pedestrian bridge almost 200 years ago. The halfpenny toll was dropped many years ago. Christ Church, Ireland's most famous, was built in the 12th century and is affiliated with the Protestant Church of Ireland. The Irish Parliament met here for several hundred years. Handel's Messiah was first sung by the cathedral's choir in a building across the street. The Saint Lawrence O'Toole was the first Irish bishop at Christ Church, and his heart is held in this container on the wall of a chapel named in his honor. On our way out of Christ Church, we met Patty, the verger of the church. A verger is a person, usually a layperson, who assists in the ordering of religious services and guards the door to the church during these services. Patty told us his life story about being raised a Catholic, then becoming an atheist in early adulthood, and finally his conversion by a Church of Ireland priest when he was facing bankruptcy as a Dublin taxi driver. He works now as a full-time employee of the church, and in his own words, "Since my conversion, I haven't been able to get the smile off my face." The next morning, we reluctantly departed this wonderful country. Its rich history and culture and its amazing people are so much a part of our American heritage. We shall return. Slán agat.